what's the thing I like about you?
Well, we're in the home stretch, and I have to tell you, one of the nicest things about chairing the Youth Safety Coalition is I've gotten to work with so many amazing millennials and great people. And I guess it was 2.5 years ago, a young lady came into our orbit, who I'd heard was a pop star, a really famous pop star, and I couldn't believe her music, and she just showed up in a pair of jeans and a t-shirt in my really sloppy, horrible office. And we talked about maybe doing something positive, you know, with her work, because she was really interested in bullying and the problems that we're facing, and we still see it so involved. And I was talking to her and said, you know, would you consider maybe singing with some autistic kids who I knew had some talent? And she said, sure, why not? So she hopped in the car, right then and there, and we drove down, and we came across a kid named Michael Korns, and I happened to iPhone that thing, I taped it. The two of them jammed, and I think they sang "We Are the Champions," right? And it was really incredibly touching. I mean, it was really magical, and I just thought this girl was incredible. And then she went off to California to do some work with Disney and some of the stuff. And then she was in Greece, touring in Greece for a while, and she came back in a hurry just to practice one song with Michael, with the idea of maybe performing in front of 300 people. I mean, that's all it was. And 3 weeks later, the two of them came to this conference and knocked the socks off. There was not a dry eye in the place. The two of them sang absolutely beautifully. And there's an epilogue to that, because now that she's back here, Michael has gone on to do some better stuff. As a matter of fact, he's not here today because he's performing at the Life's Work Gala in Manhattan tonight. He can't. But the two of them cooked up an idea of her invitation to perform at our famous football player, now baseball player, Tebow, who was doing a big charity event, you know, for challenged kids, and they're gonna sing. And they're just, so all the magic and the serendipity that occurs from these meetings is incredible, and I know there'll be more exciting things. So what, it's really exciting because Meredith O'Connor, you know, is from Colstrin Harbor, the local person, and we've got a lot of Hofstra superstars, not to put down the other schools, they're all really good, but she is a Hofstra graduate, and we had two Hofstra professors here today, so we're really, really excited about that. And she has stopped her very busy schedule. There's one thing I know about Meredith, whatever she does, it's for the vulnerable. Bullying has been her cause, but it's also mental health. You know, she went out to California and did a whole statewide youth suicide prevention piece, mobilizing high schools all over the country to challenge kids to make videos. And we're hoping we'll do something similar ourselves. So if you've got video kids at your schools, stay in touch, because I think we can do something with that. But she went to do that, and then the other day, she called to say that she's doing a fashion show, and we did went down there, and that fashion show was to donate money to her agent Rick's mother's cause for breast cancer. And there again, she had young designers being featured, you know, it was very selfless. And on top of that, when she brought performers to perform with her, it was two young stars who had breast cancer. So there's always this humanitarian side of it, which I think makes this person very, very, very special. Now she's at the UN, and she is a youth leader. I might say ambassadress, even though it's forbidden. Really, it's a terrific honor. And I think we're going to show you a little bit of a video right now to give you a little bit more orientation about the wonderful world of Meredith O'Connor.
It's never somebody's fault for being bullied, because if it is, then you're justifying the action of bullying. So I was different. But that's nothing to be ashamed of. And it took me a long time to learn that. I thought I was the only one experiencing the pain that I did, because for all I knew, I was the only one. Grew up and I realized that that's not the case. Other people go through it and it's not fair and they shouldn't have to. So I'm just so happy that I stayed strong through it all. Hi, my name is Meredith O'Connor. I'm here in the Quad Studio recording with Kenny Ortiz for my full-length album. I'm a singer-songwriter and anti-bullying advocate. I really didn't fit in, I couldn't really play sports, and performing was what I did, but a lot of them were like, oh, that's not cool. I was called ugly a lot. I was made fun of for being too tall, too thin, eyes too big, and a whole array of things. I see a lot of fans of mine too who are very, very confident, you know, very nice people, and they're really having a hard time in school. I hear like horror stories that are as bad or if not worse than mine, and the reasoning for it is so silly. I think people should respect each other instead of bring each other down. It was a bit overwhelming at first. I remember people would, you know, recognize me from the song for a while, and it was really cool. I knew that, you know, once I had this and had a platform and a fan base, I was so excited to take it to the next step and put out a message. And I've been having a really good time with that ever since. Thank you all for coming out, and thank you, Renee, for that amazing introduction. It's such an honor to be here again for this conference. I am from Long Island, and my favorite part of my job is not necessarily, touring is great and concerts are fun, but my favorite part of my job by far is the work with students in schools and working with people like Renee, Madeline Cygnus, and all these amazing people who have the passion of making sure that the people and youth who have so much potential, who may be going through something in their life, know that it can get better and have the tools for it to get better. Now, my experience has been a tough one, and I was very fortunate to have the parents that I did. And now I have learned, you know, after my anti-bullying platform came about, it taught me so much. And the things that I've learned, I've become very passionate about teaching people who listen to my music, fans, and even students at schools. Usually when I speak at a school, which is, by the way, my favorite part of everything in my job, is because of the interaction, I always ask the students, you know, how many of you have ever seen bullying happen or been bullied? And it's always, you know, of course, everyone raises their hands. And the amazing thing about my experience in life is, you know, on TV and on the radio, the first thing they ask, you know, when the topic of bullying comes up is, why were you bullied? And that answer is always hard to answer. It used to be because my voice was too low, and then it was because my voice was too high. And, you know, at the end of the day, I've learned that it really wasn't because I've done anything wrong. It took me years to learn that. In fact, I spent years not truly loving myself when I could have understood that it's not the victim's fault if they're being bullied, it's the person who's doing it. So by having the resources and having the confidence to know that it's not your fault and there are things, steps you can take, is something that I wish I'd known growing up. So it's very passionate, it's a big passion of mine to express that to people all over the world. The other question I'm often asked is, why did I not tell my mom or my dad, or why did I try to keep the secret? For me, bullying was violent, verbal, and, you know, even just not being told that I could, being told that I couldn't sit at the lunch table, all these different forms of bullying made it really hard. And it was something that I tried to hide from people. So the question of why I haven't told anyone is something I battled with for a while. And when my first song became a hit on the radio, was actually, it had nothing to do with bullying. It was through my manager, who's here today, Rick Galvin, and he signed me on the spot when I was modeling, ironically being bullied at the same time in school. So the song comes out and it was a hit, and I had a following. My life completely changed. I remember I'd be stopped in the street for selfies, and it was a very different experience, but at the same time, that was when I started to talk about what happened to me. And I went from not telling my mom because of fear, because I just didn't understand that things could get better. I just kept it to myself, and then all of a sudden, my manager said, now that you have a following, you should do something, you know, positive with it. So it was 15 strangers at a time, they're all suggesting different ideas, and then, you know, I started to share my story. For the first time out of my mind, this was like, I didn't even need to tell my mom, and now I'm telling a bunch of music executives. So the song, The Game, you know, they looked at me, and they're like, you have to write a song about that. So, you know, a couple months later, I put out a song, The Game, and I had hundreds of thousands of messages from people who said, they felt the same way. They also were, you know, abused, and they've been through this and that, and it made me feel like, oh my gosh, I'm not alone. So by seeing how many beautiful, amazing, smart, strong people were being told that they're not smart, they're not strong, they're not beautiful, and how much they believed it, I felt like, wow, I have to change this. I have to let them know that they're wrong to believe these people, putting them down. This is so sad. And then it reminded me of how I felt and how it brought my self-esteem down. So it's very hard to
to know that in the world we live in, there are beautiful, smart people believing that they're not because of what other students are saying. But the good news is, it is very easy to instill confidence in them. So the first song is called The Game, and this is that I'm going to sing today. This song I wrote, actually, this is the song that I wrote after Celebrity went viral. And it was very scary, but it taught me so much in seeing the reactions from schools around the world, and it's become my passion to let people know that things can get better.
The start, and don't let them.
there are some amazing people here in the audience. I want to thank the Northport Group for doing what they do, which is absolutely incredible. And Renee had paired me with Mike Borens, who is an amazing person who is autistic and also has this amazing talent. When we did this last year, he's basically proven that no matter what, you know, people have certain things, and you know, we all have, he has a talent, he has a photographic memory and perfect pitch. And it's the kind of thing that he is advanced in many elements. So I believe that mental health is such an important topic to discuss. And when you experience it, the work I did in California was me and the director of Lord of the Rings. We were both the judges for these competitions where students would submit their films. And some of the hardest things in middle school is going through it thinking that you are alone and not realizing that, you know, you can talk to people about it. But this, you know, what we're working on, there will be people who, it's basically a competition where students will, what happened in California is at the end of day one, they would get an autograph and picture, and it was just such an amazing experience to see how students are helping each other. So the initiative, such as the one that Renee Fisher has in place, is going to be really very beneficial to students. So it's very important to let them know that they're not alone. When I was first signed, I didn't always talk about my experience with mental health on the radio or all that other stuff. But it's something that is so important to discuss. I think, you know, my favorite example when I do speak at schools or colleges is Bill Gates, Elon Musk, and Albert Einstein, all people who have reported instances of bullying, violence, and being taunted for the very reasons that they're so successful. Bill Gates, especially, is a idol of mine who has been bullied for being, you know, too much of a nerd and what have you, but it ended up leading him to be one of the richest people in the world. So I think that, you know, I wrote a song called Just the Thing, and it was featured on Nickelodeon and all this other stuff, and it was about, when Nickelodeon made the music video, they made it about a boyfriend and a girlfriend, but when I wrote it, it was really just about having anyone in your life that understands that being different is something special. My favorite story that I always share to students is this one time I was doing a show, I don't know if it was Madison Square Garden, the theater, not stadium, but I was doing a show there. I think it was here where we had a meet and greet, and I will never forget this. A girl came up to me. She was tall, blonde, and anyone in their right mind would say she's beautiful. She's probably a teenager or something, and she was just telling me how she's getting bullied at school. And I'm, you know, sitting there listening to it, like, you know, and they're all calling, all the other girls are calling her ugly. So I'm like, okay, well, this makes no sense. But I explained to her how crazy that is, like, you know it's not true, right? This is, you know, and all this other stuff. She just seemed really upset. So I followed her back on Instagram, which, you know, people get excited. So it was a whole thing, but once I did that, I learned something. Turns out she was a model for an agency. She was doing campaigns and magazines and all these different things, and it made me question why she would believe what they're saying. So I remember spending that night after the meet and greet, I was like, I made sure I got her message, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is crazy. How can you believe what they're saying? And it truly, that is the moment that truly taught me that it is so important for people to, you know, if for example, if you have a student or a daughter or a son or whatever it is that's being told that there's something bad about them is true and they believe it, it is so crucial for them to hear stories like this just so they can understand that it's not true what people say. Mental health plays such a big part in bullying. It is, I believe, you know, it can be the cause of it. When people who have issues, whether it's with self-esteem or whatnot, when people who are afraid or who fear their safety, they may join in on bullying to protect themselves, but a lot of times what they don't know is they aren't aware of the resources and the alternatives that they can go to instead of keeping down on someone else. The most important message for anyone with a kid or a student or someone who's ever seen bullying happens to let them know that if you're lucky enough to not to ever change. So I'm doing a TEDx talk in January 28th, Laguna Beach, and it's going to be titled that. And I'm very much looking forward to it. It's also the title of my speech at the United Nations on February 24th. So it's all about embracing the things that make you different. And if you've ever heard the song, Just the Thing on the Radio, it's about just that. And it's about knowing that if you struggle or if you go through some hard times in your life, you can not only surpass them survive them, but they will make you stronger. In fact, the things that make you different are the things that make you special.
I'm awkward, a little lonely, tall and always say just the wrong thing. I talk too fast, forget to breathe. I'm tripped up in my energy. I'm out of touch and think too much. Oh, hey, I'm in the clouds and I'll probably never land. And I don't fit in with the in crowd, but I fit with you. And I don't fit in.
Small enough group, I can just call them person I see. And it can be related to really any topic. So do we have any questions? Oh, I was raised in Cold Spring Harbor. And we had some great teachers there, and it was just a matter of me having the confidence and knowing the steps to be able to speak out against it, to go to those teachers, which is something that I was always afraid to do. And it was the kind of thing where I wished when I was going there that I had, if I was told what I'm telling people now, it would have been nice so I know that I don't, because no student deserves to go through that. So I think addressing the problem is always the most important and best way to solve the problem. But yeah, so that's the town I grew up, right next to Huntington. And speaking at Huntington High School on the 21st, while we're there, so I'll be very excited about that. Any other questions? Yes. Well, I think it's important to address all different areas of bullying. I think a major problem is, because a lot of students are what we call bystanders, which is not necessarily the one being like, hey, it's just the one kind of going along with it. And in my experience, it all, as a person on the other end of it, I remember that people, once the song took off, I got so many messages on Facebook where they're like, oh, I was just afraid to stand up for you. And the presentation is a little interesting because it's coming from a perspective, whether the students know have heard me on or seen me on TV or whatever it is, it's coming from not only that, but a perspective of somebody who really went through it and was on the other end of it. So I remember that the first time, and the kids always ask, when you had the song got known, when the song was known, what did they say? A lot of it was apologies. And I think it's important to forgive. But the first time I actually, before any music thing happened, even before modeling, my best friend, who's still my best friend today, her name is Mary, she was the first person to ever stand up for me. And I love this story because people were, giving me a hard time today. She kind of was like, hey, why are we doing this? Maybe let's ease off on her. And it just took one person, whereas, you know, most people who are in the bystander position may feel afraid. And I've been in that position too. I know it's scary, but she took that scary step, and she wasn't bullied. In fact, in that situation, and I'll never forget this, and I say this to encourage them that, you know, they should stand up. By doing that, the other students copied her. So I think when you're in a position where you can be that upstander, that is my message to them. It's also, you know, if you see it happening to a friend or whatever, it's my message to them to get an adult supervision and get them involved when that's necessary. And really, it's just about what bullying is, what it means. It's the intention of hurting someone else. And most of the presentation is what to do if it happens, as well as anti-bullying techniques on how to make sure it doesn't happen. Extracurricular activities, I think, is the best way to make sure that people can build confidence in other areas instead of taking out on others. But at the end of the day, it's my biggest passion personally is making sure, just because of all the fans and students I've seen around the world who are brilliant and wonderful, who don't think they are. You know how it's upsetting, but it also inspires me to do it more, to let them know, like, hey, this isn't true, you know what I mean? So thank you. Do we have any questions? Yes.
What are you going to do at the UN?
So at the United Nations, well, I spoke at the UN Women, spoke at their summit last year, and my title is Celebrity Youth Leader. Hoping for ambassador one day, which celebrity youth leader means they send me to, they were going to send me to India, and now they have me working at a school presentation, and there's a lot of different initiatives that we're currently working on, but on February 24th with Montessori Model UN and Margot Lazaro from the NGO Committee on Sustainable Development, they're putting me in the General Assembly to address over 32 different countries' representatives. I'm very excited and a little nervous because it's like last year, but it's the main General Assembly Hall, so it'll be really fun. And it's going to be about my experience with bullying, and the title is, we're either going to title it You Are Not Alone, or If You're Lucky Enough to Be Different, Don't Ever Change, which is a bit of a long title, so we'll try to figure out how to squeeze that in one heading. But that's what I'm doing there, and we have more initiatives to be announced that we're working on in a meeting last week on it, so I'm very excited. Yes. Yeah, well, I think that's a really great question. I think that open dialogue, first of all, getting open dialogue is important. The hardest thing that for me was to tell, like, you know, if you were a counselor or something, me going up to you and saying, like, hey, this is what's going on, was so hard. Because I blamed myself. You know, when it got physical and all sorts of different things had happened, I, just like somebody who's a victim of abuse, and when your safety's in danger, a lot of times the human brain goes, it's my fault, you know? And it's something that we teach in the classrooms, and it definitely is something that happened to me. And because I blamed myself, I didn't realize that I had the resources that I could go up to. So by having that open dialogue to the people who are being bullied, I think letting them know that it's not their fault, that they're not alone, and to speak up about it, is important. And I thought that the mean names that they were calling me and all these horrible things, you know, I thought it was true. So I thought that what was happening to me was something that I deserved. And it sounds bad, and it sounds sad, and it's what a lot of people who are under the extreme cases are feeling. But by letting them know that they don't deserve to go through it, it's almost like a shift of reality in their mind. And getting them to realize that there are people to talk to and to open that dialogue is the first step. I think once you have that dialogue going, then it becomes more accessible to kind of get to the crux of where, you know, they have low confidence, things that they are good at. I think, you know, for me, with ADD, with dyslexia and OCD, there were things that I wasn't good at, like certain classes in school. And then there were things that I were good at, such as performing and all that other stuff, and chorus, whatever. You know, so that was where I shined. And I think that embracing people's differences is always good for people who have suffered with, you know, whether it's mental health, a learning disability, or what have you, just letting them know that it's okay to be different. And in fact, those are the things that make world leaders, if that makes sense. So yeah, and the fact, so thank you so much. Okay, all right, so we'll do one more question, but at the end, I know it's always interesting to, one of my favorite parts of coming back to New York is working with Renee Fischer for things like this, so I would love to speak with anyone after, of course. Do we have one more question? Yes. So we just finished the soundtrack. There's a movie, Sony's doing a movie about my life. Sony UK, and I'm very excited. So I went to LA this summer to do the soundtrack for it. And we're hoping that we start pre-production by January. And it's starring me, Garrett Clayton from Teen Beach Movie, and Addison Ricky from the Thundermans. She's playing the younger version of me who gets bullied in school. And it's about facing your fears. It's essentially about the story of, it's a fictional movie, but it's based loosely on my life. And at the end, you know, it's very uplifting. And I'm very excited for it, but I hope we start filming in January. But we didn't complete the soundtrack this summer. I'm very excited. So thank you for that question. It's called Playing the Game. And it's on IMDb. We actually announced it on Thrive. Ariana Huffington has this new thing, so we did a thing on Thrive and Huffington Post, and something will come out on Deadline soon about it, so I'm very excited. No one knows I can act, which will be a fun, hopefully, not a surprise for the world by the time it comes out. So, speaking of Garrett Clayton, one of the allies that I worked with in the world of anti-bullying, one of his representatives, one of his representatives contacted my manager, Rick. He's the main actor in Teen Beach Movie. He played Tanner. I don't know if you guys have seen the movie, but it's always, you know. So he played Tanner in the movie, and they reached out about our anti-bullying advocacy. So we wrote the song together. And this is probably my favorite song that I wrote, because it's not just about surviving challenges. It's about making those challenges, whether it's stuff at home, whether it's grades, sports, bullies, anything. It's about those things that will make you stronger in life, because you'll use that experience to help others. And that's the message behind this song. So this song is called Stronger, and if you've heard it on Radio Disney, or I always say you can sing along, but this is one of my favorite songs because it's all about embracing the message of overcoming challenges. Thank you guys so much.
Go farther than I ever could. Thank you guys so much. So, we were actually, as Renee, thank you so much. And Renee had mentioned this, the show at the PlayStation Theater, which my manager actually produced. Aaron Carter had opened for me that day, and right after we went to California, Congress and the Senate had honored the school presentation as being one of the most effective for youth. And I think that having an open dialogue is so important, and treating it as a form of abuse when it comes to violence or any kind of harassment is important, because the good news is there is a solution. And I've seen some amazing administrators. I think the ones, you know, as long as the dialogue is open, there is a way to make sure that things do get better. So it's one of my favorite parts of my job for that reason. Now, this last song is called I Am, and it's about embracing who you are. It's about, we're having a campaign with Vivo and MTV when the music video is released, which will be very soon, and I'm very excited for that. Writing the song was very similar to the concept of Just the Thing, and it's about embracing the things that make you different.
They don't believe it. Just prove them all wrong.
It's been a really super good conference. We have one last thing for those of you who are out there saving lives and concerned about the heroin overdose problems. Stay, because there will be the Narcan training for those who need it. Those of you who are looking for, you know, education professional credits, don't forget, to get it, you have to sign out to the respective desk, one for mental health, another for social workers. For those with education, that you'll get an email, you send an email, they'll send you back the credit. So I think it's okay. Now I need your feedback, so don't forget, if you have something happy to say or something sad, tell me so we can fix it. So on behalf of the DA's office, our incredible team of people, I thank everybody, especially Meredith, who knocked our socks off tonight. God bless you. Have a great time. Thank you.
It's just the thing I like about you. It's just the thing I like about you.